Talk by Father Jeremy Habayaramina. Blessed are those who bear the fruit in Jesus Christ. Memory of Saint Timothy and Saint Titus Bishops. Readings. I will establish after you the descendants, and I will establish their kingship. A reading from the second book of Samuel, 7, verse 4 to 17. That night the Lord spoke to Nathan and said, Go, tell my servant David, thus that says the Lord, shall you build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day on which I led the children of Israel out of Egypt to the present, but I have been going about in a tent under cloth. In all my wanderings, everywhere among the children of Israel, did I ever utter a word to any one of the judges whom I charged to tend my people Israel to ask, Why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now then, speak thus to my servant David. The Lord of hosts has this to say, It was I who took you from the pasture and from the care of the flock to be commander of my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you went, and I have destroyed all your enemies before you, and I will make you famous like the great ones of the earth. I will fix a place for my people Israel. I will plant them so that they may dwell in their place without further disturbance. Neither shall the wicked continue to afflict them as they did of old, since the time I first appoint judges over my people Israel. I will give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord also reveals to you that he will establish a house for you. And when your time comes and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your hair after you, a sprung for your loins, and I will make his kingdom firm. It is he who shall build a house for my name, and I will make his royal throne firm forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. And if he does wrong, I will correct him with the rod of men, and with human chastisements. But I will not withdraw my favor from him as I withdrew it from your predecessor Saul, whom I removed from my presence. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me. Your throne shall stand firm forever. Nathan reported all this word and this entire vision to David. Response and Psalm. Psalm 88. Response. Forever I will maintain my love for my servant. I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David my servant. I will make your dynasty stand forever and establish your throne through all ages. Forever I will maintain my love for my servant. He shall cry to me, You are my father, my God, the rock that brings me victory. I myself make him firstborn, most high over the kings of the earth. Forever I will maintain my love for my servant. Forever I will maintain my love for him. My covenant with him stands firm. I will establish his dynasty forever, his throne as the days of the heavens. Forever I will maintain my love for my servant. Alleluia. The seed is the word of God. Christ the shower, all who comes to him will live forever. Gospel. The shower went out to show, a reading of the Holy Gospel according to Mark 4, verse 1 to 20. On one occasion, Jesus began to teach by the sea. A very large crowd gathered around him, so that he got into a boat on the sea and sat down. And the whole crowd was besides the seat on the land. And he touched them at length in parables, and in the course of his instruction he said to them, Hear this, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, Some seed fell on the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Other seed fell on the rock ground, where it had little soil. It sprang up at once because the soil was not deep. And when the sun rose, it was scorched and it withered for lack of roots. Some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and cooked it, and it produced no grain. And some seed fell on rich soil and produced fruit. It came up and grew and yield 30, 60, and 100-fold. He had whatever has ears to hear, out to hear. And when he was alone, those presents, along with the 12, questioned him about the parables. He answered them, "The mystery of the kingdom of God has been granted to you, but to those outside everything comes in parables, so that they may look and see but not perceive, and hear and listen but not understand, in order that they may not be converted and be forgiven." Jesus said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? Then how will you understand any of the parables? The sower sows the word. They are the ones on the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear, Satan comes at once and takes away the word sown in them. And these are the ones sown on the rocky ground, who, when they hear the word, receive it at once with joy, but they have no root. They last only for a time. Then when tribulation or persecution comes before of the word, they quickly fall away. Those sown among thorns are another sort. They are the people who hear the word, but worldly anxiety, the lure of riches, and the craving for other things intrude and cloak the word, and it bears no fruit. But those sown on rich soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it, and bear fruit 30, 60, and 100-fold. First talk. Dear brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ appears to us today to show in our lives the seeds of eternal life, his word. Blessed are those who hear the voice of Jesus and his word abides in them. That is a gift of the Holy Spirit, because if the Spirit does not open our ears, we don't hear anything that Jesus Christ tells us. Once the word has been kept, everything must be uproot that may prevent it from bearing fruit, and Jesus Christ speaks of these impediments in the Gospel. There are others who receive the seed among the bushes. They are the ones who listen to the word, but the cares of life, the seduction of wealth, and the desire for everything else invite them. They drown the word, and it remains sterile. The seed of Jesus in our life, once sown in good soil, necessarily bears fruit. When it is sown and not reaped, nothing is, because the land is not good. And what to do to make the land good? Only Jesus Christ can do it. But recognizing that your land is bad is an important step. To recognize it, you have to look at the fruits. What fruit has my Christian life borne? And the fruits are not the things that I do well, but the seeds generated in others. A grain that produces another grain. A Christian that generates another Christian. Every true conversion generates other conversions, and every false conversion blocks many others. It is a false testimony. It is a scandal. We can honestly examine our lives looking around us. Who have we given the life of Jesus? If there is no one, it is because we have not allowed the word of Christ to grow in us. And if it has grown, it has also done so with thistles that we have not wanted to start. Those thistles have many Christians who pray, who receive sacraments, but they also have the cares of life, the seduction of riches, and the desire for everything else invade them. They drown the world and they remain sterile. That invasion does not allow any fruit. In other words, Jesus is not the first in that heart. There are other little things. When you have to choose by renouncing evil or sacrificing yourself to do good, at that moment the tistles show their power and you choose according to the desires of flesh, riches. And that person who prays or does charity still has something that is missing, a door that does not open, and another that does not close. The one that does not open is because of the one that never comes out to the harvest, and the one that does not close because of the anxiety, seduction, fantasy, and lies. Such a person cannot bear any fruit. As St. Paul tells us, those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified their body, their passion, and their desires on the cross of Jesus. Galatians 5, verse 24. Only they can bear the fruit of eternal life in others. Come, Holy Spirit, glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Immaculate Heart of Mary, protect us. Our Lady of Carmen, pray for us. Jesus Christ, be praised. Jesus, I trust in you. Second talk. Dear brothers, today Jesus Christ appears to pour out his infinite mercy on us. He only asks for one condition, that we accept our sin. He will not kill us for having sinned, but he will forgive us. The kingdom of Jesus is poured out on us, tearing away our sins and purifying our whole life. Every time we accept that we have sinned, now or in the past, we have taken an important step on our path to holiness. The work of evil one is not to ensure that we do not acknowledge our sin, either by rejecting it or by blaming others. This is how all unconverted people act. They always accuse others. Everything that happens to them is the fault of this or that person. They are always the others. However, those who begin the path of holiness beat their chest. Mercy, Lord, we have sinned. Mercy, Lord, I am a sinner. This is an attitude of conversion. Anyone who acknowledges their sin is because Christ's blood has begun to purify him. It is poured out in his life to our root and cleans that sin with its root, branches and consequence, its wounds. But when begin a sinner is openly rejected, sin grows along with its corresponding consequences and hearts. The example we have today is David before his conversion. We can see how there sin grew. His first sin, I would say, was doing nothing, his indifference. While his army was fighting, he was pacing. It is an attitude that symbolizes laziness. He then fixed his gaze on Bathsheba in a non-controlled, irresponsibility way and thus result in adultery. He did not repent and want to hide his sin, while it grew and grew as well as its consequences and so on until it granted death. The growth of sin produced the death of Uriah and the death of many people in the city. The cause was that David has not recognized his sin. He had not repented. The spiral of sin continued to grow, and after the death of Uriah, and many people in the city, David took a new step with Bathsheba, Uriah's wife who was not his. It is the gravity of unrepentant sin. In Psalm 50, attributed to David, as we read it, he finally acknowledged his sin. He repented, asked the Lord for mercy, and he forgave him. We can ask ourselves about the history of our sins. Do they continue to grow, or have we recognized them, and are we asking for forgiveness? Mercy, Lord, Jesus, I have sinned many times, for my pride, for my envy, for my rage, for my impurity, for my anger, for my lies. Have mercy on me, Lord. Mercy, we have sinned. By your goodness, Lord Jesus, forgive us. We must acknowledge our sin. Sin is very serious. But the love that Jesus Christ has for us is much stronger. And whenever we are sincerely convert, the Lord forgives us and continues to heal, sanctify, transform us, because the Lord died for our sins. This growth process is spoken of in the gospel. It is that small seed that is put in the ground, that grows little by little, step by step. We must respect the rhythm of our Christian life. What the Lord asks us is simple, is that we welcome the seed. That it germinates and grows depends on your gift, only on Him, nothing more. We have to accept Jesus Christ, allow His goodness, His love, His truth to invite us, allowing us to be taken by His love little by little. It's not us who do it. It is not our work. It's a free gift from the Lord. Let yourself be blessed and protected by Jesus Christ, instead of protecting yourself with your bad words, with your bad look, with your useless effort, with your indifference, and with everything you can do. Let yourself be taken by the power of Christ, by His love who dies for you. Let Him reign over you. The kingdom is a small seed that grows, and in the beginning it often provokes some contempt on the part of others. In the time of Saint Francis, there were many successful entrepreneurs. They had many employees. They had a lot of money and people talk about them. Meanwhile, Saint Francis has stripped himself of everything and the world made fun of him. But today, after so many centuries, what has happened? The little seed of Saint Francis has grown. For the entrepreneurs of his time, Saint Francis had been lost. And today, it is them that nobody remembers. It is they who were useless for our time. Saint Francis, because of his poverty, because of his total generosity, continues to change today. Our time continues to teach us. As an example, we have a pope named Francis after him. Who could imagine it at that time? Therefore, we cannot despise what we are doing now invisibly. They often discourage us when we want to go to worship, even make fun of us. But we know that those are seeds of love. They will grow and bear fruit in you and in the whole world. Throughout the entire history of humanity, Jesus Christ supports those who obey Him, those who allow themselves to be seduced by His love, dominated by His humility and by His goodness. Come, Holy Spirit, glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Immaculate Heart of Mary, protect us.